Today I'll be talking about using Python and microservices to fuel WebPush at Mozilla. So I'll begin by introducing myself. My name is Mansimar Kaur, and I was a Google Summer of Code participant for this year with Homebrew. I worked on improving the test suite for Brew and increasing its test coverage. For those of you who do not know what Brew is, it's a package manager for OS X. And the ones who use OS X, they should definitely check it out. It'll ease your life as a developer a lot. And while I was doing my Google Summer of Code, I also interned at HackerRank. I worked on their auto-completion service. And I was also an Outreachy participant for the last year's round, which was round 13. It took place from December 2016 to March 2017. I'm a final year undergrad at Netaji Subhas Institute of Technology, and I'm pursuing a BE in Computer Engineering. And I'm also mentoring for this round of Outreachy with the organization Sisters. And I'm also a mentor for an initiative called Learn It Girl. So for those of you who do not know what Outreachy is, it's an initiative of the Software Freedom Conservancy. Through Outreachy, free and open source organizations hire interns to work remotely on open source projects in collaboration with mentors. So these interns get a stipend of 5,500 USD and a tribal stipend of 500 USD. It's open to participation for women, trans men, and genderqueer people. And for more information, you can log on to outreachy.org. And the ones who are eligible for it should definitely apply. There are two rounds every year. Now, addressing the elephant in the room, which is WebPush. So I'll begin by describing how WebPush notifications actually work. Right from the time when you see that pop-up prompting you, asking you for permission to send you notifications, to the time when you actually see that notification arrive on your screen, what is it that goes on behind the scenes, what all elements are at play, and like what is the entire terminology and like what all goes on, let's begin by discussing that. So there are three main characters in the WebPush story that I'm going to be narrating today. The first one is the service worker, second one is the push server, and the third one is the web app server. After I finish describing the entire working of the WebPush technology, I'll be discussing how one can go on to design a web app server that can handle push notifications, You can either integrate it into the web application that you have, or you can build a third-party service that your web application calls to when notifications have to be sent out. So I'll begin from left to right describing what each one of them does. Just a second. So a service worker is basically a JavaScript file that acts as a background worker. It has control over the web pages and sites that it is associated with, and it is able to background sync APIs, and it's able to handle notifications. A service worker remains active even when your website or your web page is closed. So it's powerful stuff, right? If it can work even when your browser is closed and like you're not accessing that website. So since it's so powerful, there comes responsibility with it. So a service worker can only be registered on a web page or a website that is served over HTTPS. Also, a service worker is not associated with a particular page or a tab, although it can send events to it. Since it's not associated with a particular web page or a tab, it does not have access to DOM. And in the future, service workers will be able to periodic sync, and they'll be able to support geofencing. Now, geofencing is the API through which you can mark, through which your web application can mark geographic boundaries at different places, and when your device enters or exits that area, you will be receiving notifications. Now, coming to the next part, the push server. The push server basically acts as the middleman between your web app server and your service worker, routing the payload between them. Now, how does this exactly happen after, say, like somehow the web server is able to send a request to your push server, and the push server has the push notification or the message that has to be sent across? Now, the push server uses a thing called a UAID to identify you as a user, to identify your browser, basically. UAID's full form is user agent ID. So it's basically identifying you as a user. And each browser is associated with the, each browser is identified with a particular UAID. Now, when the say the browser has received the notification through the UAID, how does it actually like send it across to the service worker? So there's a thing called a channel ID through which a browser identifies the respective service worker. Like it identifies for which website this from which website this notification has come come from, and with service workers to be woken up saying, "Hey, you have a notification. Please display it or do something in the background." So you have a service worker. What next? For a website to be able to push you notifications, it needs to have a service worker that is active. Now, what do I mean by an active service worker? So, whenever you visit a website that has a service worker associated with it, first thing, the service worker has to be registered with the service worker container.register method. And then, immediately a service worker file is downloaded. And after this downloading, it's checked if this file that has been downloaded is new. If it's a new file, then it's installed. And if there are no more pages using the old service worker that are loaded anymore, this particular service worker file is activated. So that's when the first step towards our WebPush journey is done. This is not like this is. I'm just this piece of pseudocode you see is nothing like what is actually like used. I mean, it's just a dummy code where I'm trying to explain what happens. Then you basically see this pop-up coming on your screen after your service worker is active now. So I choose to receive notifications, and then a call to push manager, the function push manager dot subscribe is called. This sends a request from the service worker to the push server of the browser saying, "Hey, I want to subscribe to notifications. Please give me a subscription." Now, what is a subscription? A subscription basically has two things with it. The first thing is the capability URL, and the second thing is your encryption keys. Now, on the web, there are two ways through which you can access information. The first one will be through a token or a password, and the second one would be the information is available at some obscure URL, and people who should have access to that information are the only ones who have access to that URL. So such a URL is called the capability URL. So the first thing your subscription contains is your capability URL. And the second thing it contains is the encryption keys. These are basically used to encrypt the payload. Now, say you have to a top secret stuff. You have some top secret object or something you have to get delivered to yourself from some agent. You need to inform the agent about what top secret stuff you want, first thing. Second thing, the agent needs to know where your address is, where the thing is to be delivered, and what do you want to wrap that top secret stuff in so that there are the other people do not come to know. So similarly, in the case of the WebPush scenario, the service worker sends across the encryption keys and the capability URL, basically the entire subscription across to the web app server, saying, "Hey, like this is my address and this is how you have to wrap up my stuff. You have to encrypt my payload and send it to me whenever I need that information." Now, say a person, say you're on a website buying some clothes, and like there's a section for a particular clothing line, and there is some stuff that is out of stock, and you want to be notified when that stuff is in stock again. So you're basically wanting to subscribe to only a particular kind of notification. You don't want to be notified for everything that goes out of stock, right? You want to be notified about only the stuff in that particular clothing line. So for that, there's a thing called channels. Channels are basically like your TV channels. I mean, channels will have information about one particular kind of thing only. So the service worker then needs to inform the web app server about what channel it wants to subscribe to, basically what kind of information it wants to be notified about. So it sends across its request to the web app server saying, "Hey, I want to subscribe to these particular channels, this particular channel. You already have my subscription, you have my encryption keys and my capability URL, you know where to reach out to me, and now I'm telling you what messages I want," right? So then the web app server needs to store these credentials, and then say the time has arrived that, you know, a notification has to be sent out. So the web app server has the payload with it. it retrieves the subscriptions that were there for that particular channel, and then it picks out each subscription individually, takes out, uses the encryption key associated with each subscription and encrypts the payload individually. Then this, after the encryption has been done, the web app server sends a post request to the HTTP server along with a TTL header. Now, TTL stands for time to live header, that was mentioned in the last talk as well. So, basically what the TTL defines is, if the user is not online, your request, basically your push message will be queued up on the push server for a certain amount of time until the user comes online, right? So, the TTL will define for how long the message can stay on the push server. If the TTL is crossed, like if the value of the TTL that you specified has been, like it's over, then the message will no longer be sent across to the user. Now, if the user is online, the push server then contacts the browser using the UAID, the user agent ID, which is derived from the capability URL we got in the first place, and then the browser contacts the respective service worker, again the using the channel ID, which was derived from, which is again derived from the capability URL, and the payload is routed across from the web app server through the push server to the browser and then to the service worker. Now, the service worker in Chrome and Firefox, I'll come to this after I mention the show notification API. So, then the service worker has received the push notification message. It can choose to, if it has to display the push notification message, it uses the show notification API and displays it using the service worker registration.showNotification. Now, there's a thing that Chrome does not have a limit on the number of push notifications you can send, but there's a catch. You cannot do things in the background. If you're sending across a push message, it needs to be shown as a notification. You cannot be doing things in the background. While in Firefox, there is a limit on the number of push notifications that you can send, but you can choose to do things in the background and not display the notification. Now, a little overview. I'm not sure if this is visible to all of you. Like, just a brief summary of the entire thing that happens. So, you get the pop-up, you get the pop-up asking for a permission, you click on yes. Service worker sends a request to the push server. The push server responds back with the encryption keys and the capability URL, which is basically your subscription. And then your subscription is sent to the web app server. And then your service worker informs the web app server about the channels you want to be notified about. And when a push notification is to be sent out, the payload is encrypted using the encryption keys that we got in the first place with the subscription. And then this is routed across to the push server using a post request. And the push server then can send it across to the browser if the user is online. If the user is not online, then the push server queues the message for like the time specified in the time to live header, and then the service worker can choose to display the notification using the show notification API. So this is the entire working of the thing. Now, coming to the part where I talk about how you can go on, how we designed the web app server that we did for push notifications. So the challenges were that the amount of notifications that you have to send out is huge. So this can lead to slowing down of the request response time, and then you need to have a provision to store and retrieve the subscriptions, and then that should be done quickly, right? And then you also need to handle the errors and the retries. And then you need to be able to encrypt encrypt the payload for every single subscription that you have. And then you need to be able to send this message across in one request in like pretty quickly, right? So let me begin by describing how we handle users. Like, this is where I start talking about how the designing happened after like I've discussed the challenges. Just a second. What about users now? So there is no user management, none at all. That means we don't, like, you cannot have usernames, or you don't have options to change passwords or anything. However, there's a catch. We still can uniquely identify users. Now, how is that possible? So basically, we use the request headers to authenticate the users, and we use third party identity providers to do the authentication and assign the user ID. There are multiple identity providers available in the wild, for example, Hawk Sessions, JWT, OAuth 2, and we used OAuth 2 bearer tokens. Now, in our model, I can call it model, I guess, we have subscribers and we have channels, right? There are subscribers who are subscribing to certain channels and they want to be notified about that information. So, this rings a bell, in my mind about the push subscribe paradigm, the pub sub paradigm, I'm so sorry, publish subscribe paradigm. Now, what is this jargon? So, publish subscribe paradigm has basically two things. There are publishers and there are subscribers. Publishers are the ones who publish information and send across information. Subscribers are the ones listening to that information. Now, when a publisher has to send out information in publish subscribe paradigm, it doesn't need to send a request to every single subscriber, like one at a time. There's just one channel, and everyone who is listening to that channel is able to receive that notification by the publisher. So, this is an overview of what the publish subscribe paradigm is. So, now I have discussed what paradigm we are using. We are using the PubSub paradigm. And then we need to have two endpoints, because we need to store information about subscriptions first of all. Then we need to store information about channels. So, there are two endpoints that we need to manage. And then for the authentication, we use OAuth 2 bearer tokens, or like if any other identity provider you want to use. How to go about designing this, and developing this entire structure that we've discussed right now. So, I have something to share, like I have a surprise. So, how many of you heard of Kinto.core? Anyone? Okay. So, hopefully the next time someone asks you that, you know, you'll be able to know. Kinto.core is basically a toolkit designing of HTTP microservices really easy. It's basically used data-driven REST APIs. It's based on good practices which are followed at Mozilla and elsewhere. It's extensible and customizable, has a lot of generic endpoints available, and gives you a lot of independence and freedom to customize your web application or your project according to you. So, we use Kinto.core to develop the microservice that I'm discussing today. There are a number of other projects that have been built using Kinto.core. You can go check them out. Kinto.core is built on the shoulders of giants. It uses Cornis for the REST helpers, and Pyramid for the HTTP stuff, and SQL Alchemy Core for database session and pooling. Now, let me discuss the features that it has, and the features that are specific to the webs to the service I'm discussing today, and like picked out from the huge plethora of options and features that are available with Kinto.core. So, it has a few generic endpoints. You have your hello view at the root URL, giving you information, general information about your service, and then it has a heartbeat URL. Now, as I discussed, one of the challenges was handling errors. So, Kinto.core does it for you. You can format your errors and you can specify a custom formats for it. Then it also takes care of your back off and retry after headers. Now, coming to the part where like there were some generic endpoints that we had, but now we need to customize the service for our use case. We needed to have two endpoints, as I discussed. One was subscriptions. Second was channels. So, subscriptions will basically store the subscriptions that we got back from the service worker. The two things, capability URL and the encryption keys. So, subscriptions are stored, and how subscriptions are stored is that the service worker sends across a post request on this endpoint, post slash subscriptions, and then these subscriptions are saved. If you want to retrieve your subscription information, that can be done using get slash subscriptions. If you want to delete all the subscriptions, delete it using delete slash subscriptions. And if a particular subscription has to be deleted, it can be deleted using delete slash subscription slash subscription ID. Now, coming to the channels endpoint. So as I discussed, channels are just like TV channels. You subscribe to a particular channel. You can also subscribe to a channel that is non-existent. That means you can create a new channel if you can create a new channel on the fly. So put /channel/channel ID/registration will create your new channel, and /delete/channel/channel ID/registration will help you delete that particular channel. If you want information about a particular channel ID, about how many users have subscribed to a particular channel, how many times push messages have been sent to a particular channel, that you can get through /channel/channel ID. Now /post/channel/channel ID, what this does is its implementation has to be such that it encrypts the subscriptions and then sends across to the push server. So post/channel/channel ID, it fetches all the subscriptions for a particular channel, picks each one of them up, encrypts the payload using the encryption keys associated with it, and then routes it across to the push server. Now I wrote this article on the working of WebPush, and it got like some attention, and then these are some of the things some of the people had to say about WebPush. So like, it's a major source of annoyance on the internet, and like, it's just, you don't want push notifications every 10 minutes, everyone is trying to send notifications and all that. So with something so powerful as WebPush, it needs to be handled with care, right? It's the responsibility of us as developers that we don't bombard users unnecessarily, since they can block you out and then you don't get the chance to send them any notification. So you're not taking any advantage of the power that comes with WebPush. So for users, I'm going to share just like how you can block out notifications. So I'll begin with Chrome first, and then I'll tell you what to do in Firefox. You can go to Settings, Advanced, and then Content Settings, Notification, then you can block it out. And then for Firefox, it's a little different. You have to visit the About config page. And like, you have to be really careful, because if you mess up something in the About config page, it could really mess your Firefox up. So you accept the risk. And then I search for notifications in the search bar. Just a second, I'm pretty sure it's not visible. I search for notifications in the search bar, and then I disable dome.webnotifications.enabled. So that's how I cut out if I don't want any notification. Now, now Chrome allows you to make exceptions. Basically, if you've toggled the block button, then if you want to make exceptions for some websites, you can do that in your preferences, but Firefox does not allow you to do that. If you have chosen to block out notifications, it will be blocked out for all of them. Now, for web application developers, it's important that they take care when they're pushing out notifications, they take care what time of the day it is, take care of the geographic location, and know what the time zone the person is in, and then send across a push notification at a time when the person is not annoyed by it. And please build some trust of the user the first time the user is coming to the website, and you're just bombarding them with, hey, can I send you push notifications? It does not make sense. You need to build their trust, let them like wait for the right opportunity, and then ask for permission. Now, Kinto.core is basically a project of Kinto. This was the project that I was working on under Mozilla. It's a minimalistic JSON storage service that is used and developed at Mozilla. It's used for a number of things in Firefox. It's used for remote settings and storage.sync API in Firefox. And there are two client libraries that are embedded in Firefox. One is the Kinto HTTP API, and one is the Kinto offline client. Kinto is also used for storing A/B testing experiment information and for iOS. Then it's also used to maintain a list of blocklisted plugins and malicious plugins, so that you don't end up using them. So for those of you who would like to start contributing to Kinto, it's open source. Kinto.core is also open source. You can find us on github.com/kinto. And it has well-labeled issues, so like even for beginners, it's a very beginner-friendly project. So if you're looking for starting to contribute, Kinto is a great place. Do give it a try, and like you can contact us on Slack and IRC. And I'd like to thank my mentor Remy. He really helped me and guided me throughout my project. So thank you so much. Yeah, I'm open for questions.
Guys, if you have any questions, just raise your hand and I'll come with the mic.
In starting, you said you want a notification even when your browser is not open. And then you said you will see notification, matlab server will send you notification only when you open your browser.
No. So, have you like subscribed to notifications ever? Like, have you tried?
Yeah, I have.
So, necessarily your browser does not need to be open, right? You get the notification even when your browser is not open.
Yeah, but when you were explaining the working, you said the server will send this tag it has created only when the browser is open.
No. When the user is online, basically you have internet connectivity.
Okay.
When I said the user is online, I just meant that the user is connected to the internet. That's if the user is not connected to the internet, only in that case your push notification will be queued, because we cannot afford to lose that notification if the user is not online. So for a certain amount of time, it's queued.
Any more questions?
So it sounds like Kinto is very good at storing JSON documents. Does it have support for storing anything like binary blobs or binary data? Other than encoding it as Base64 or something and putting it into JSON? Just wondering if you could easily store binary data with it.
Okay. So I'm not sure about it. Like, I'm not sure. I've never, never seen such a use case, or I've never used it like that. But since it's a I'm not sure, sorry. I refrain from answering because I'm not aware of it. Okay.
Any more questions, or we'll break for the panel discussion now? All right, thank you once more.
Thanks.
So the panel discussion would start in the main audience now, so you can